Oasis in his magazine.
Good afternoon. I'd like to announce that Secretary Cohen just signed the enhanced air package requested by General Clark earlier this week. Let me run through quickly what is involved in this package. This is a total of 82 airplanes. And this includes 24 additional F-16 CJ fighters, which are armed with HARM missiles and used for the suppression of enemy air defenses. 4 additional A-10 close air support aircraft. They're attack aircraft, obviously, but they can also be used in their observer role as OA-10s for helping to scout out targets on the ground. 6 additional EA-6B Prowlers, which will also be used in the suppression of enemy air defenses, along with the 24 F-16 CJs. 39 KC-135 tankers, and 2 KC-10 tankers. In addition, there will be 7 C-130 transport aircraft in the package. And that should add up to 82 aircraft. The addition of these aircraft will, of course, allow us to do 2 things. Expand the number of strikes over any 24-hour-a-day period, and 2, give us more deep strike capacity as necessary. So basically, it will allow us to increase the intensity of the air campaign over Kosovo and Yugoslavia. With that, I think I'll turn this over to General.
Just ask you one thing quickly, Ken. How many planes, around figure, does that bring the total U.S. force to?
Close to 500. We've got about 400 there now. This is another 82, so it's approximately 480. This is U.S.
Is this 82 in addition to those that were just announced over the past couple of days?
Well, yesterday we announced some 6 F-15C fighters, and these are on top of those planes that we announced. Bill?
Why did you only ask for 4 A-10s when so much more is needed in the way of suppression of tanks and other mobile equipment?
Well, we've got a number of planes that can do that, and Admiral Wald, who's an F-16 pilot, can speak to that and the capability. I added 2 stars, right? General Wald can speak to that, but this is what General Clark asked for. He has the clearest idea of what he needs to perform his military mission, and he felt this was sufficient. John?
Can you explain the contrast between the speed with which this has been approved and the length of time it took to approve the Apaches?
This was a decision that came in fully, request that came in fully formed. The Apache request came in stages. It was made verbally, but the paperwork had to follow, and then we had to go through a fairly extensive process of finding out where the best place to put the Apaches was. Also, the Apaches was a more complex force package in that it involves not only the Apaches, but multiple launch rocket systems and a significant on-ground force protection package. So it was a question of working out where to put it, and exactly what the package was going to be.
What's the overall Navy, I beg your pardon, the overall NATO air package now and around for your Anna? Other countries
before this, it was 600, and so now it'll be about 680 or so. And to answer your next question, I anticipate that other allies will be announcing a force enhancement soon. Elizabeth.
Will this require calling up more Air Force reservists to support these plans?
That is a very good question, and the answer to that is, I believe, no. But let me explain that, and General Wald may want to say more about this. Right, as you know, many of the tankers are, in fact, flown by reservists. And General Wald is frequently tanked up from reserve tankers on combat operations over Bosnia and other places. So far, all those reservists have been volunteers, and therefore there has had to be no presidential call-up of pilots to fly the tankers or other support missions. Should we reach a point where we exhaust the volunteer pool, then we probably would have to seek a reserve call-up for pilots. Now, there may be other parts of this mission that will require reserve call-ups. As you know, there are certain specialties that exist only in the reserves. One would be Army Civil Affairs officers. If we were to deploy Army Civil Affairs officers as part of Task Force Hawk, that is the Apache task force going to Albania, they would have to be called up, or if maybe we could get enough volunteers, but it's conceivable that there would have to be a reserve call-up for that. Having said that, there has been no final decision on this, but it is something that could be a possibility in the future.
Can I ask, yes? When do you expect all of these new planes to be on the ground, in the theater, ready to take part in airstrikes? And second part, is there a new estimate when the Apache, the full 24 helicopter Apache contingent may be ready to join?
I know of no new estimate on that, but I'm going to let General Wald answer the question about when they'll be in theater and ready to participate in operations.
Once again, we'll start with the weather, then we'll go through a little bit of ops. I have a couple of videos for some battle damage assessment and also some actual slides on that. As I mentioned yesterday, the weather over the last couple of days has not been very good. It's been in the red, but I am ready to tell you that we are flying strikes today in spite of the weather, and as they see the weather break, they're prepared to go ahead and do that. So. It's a little better from the standpoint of operations than we thought it would be. And the next couple of days still looks a little bit bad for weather. But as I explained yesterday, the weather can change dramatically over a period of time, either in isolated spots or overall. So we're hoping for the best there. Because of yesterday, as I mentioned, only four target areas. Once again, more than one impact point in those areas, primarily fuel for sustainability, and their command and control for both execution of operations and the integrated air defense systems were hit yesterday by both cruise missiles and U.S. NATO fighters, F-15s, and the like. Next. You asked about Task Force Hawk. I'll just give you a quick rundown of the type of vehicles that are with Task Force Hawk. Of course, the heart of Task Force Hawk is the Apache helicopter. They'll have Bradley fighting vehicles there for force protection. They're in place as we speak. They have a radar for support of the MLRS launchers. They also have heavy lift helicopters and some medevac and general utility helicopters. The deployment is moving as we speak. The force protection is in place, most of it. They have the advanced team for the reception of the forces and for the distribution of the force when it gets in place. They've had, as I heard just before I came in here, 14 to 15 C-17 sorties have already closed in Tirana and offloaded. They're hoping, if the weather holds, to get through about 20 of those lift sorties today. And as Mr. Bacon and I have mentioned earlier, they're still hoping for an initial capability, yes, a partial capability to employ within 7 to 10 days from now. Of course, that depends on the weather, and there is a balance, of course, with the humanitarian ops going on, but the operational part, of course, is not taking a back seat. That, once again, is in conjunction with General Clark's plans. He's happy with this. And additionally, I might add that as these forces get in place, they will be folded into the air operation as we see it today, and will be part of the overall air campaign, and will be folded into the ATO, the air tasking order, that's being developed at the Combined Air Operations Center at Vicenza, Italy. Next slide.
Have they set up the 24-hour operation at Tirana yet?
That's a good question. Today we hope to have the approach control certified by the FAA at Tirana. As you know, the field there did not have some of the approach control capability that we needed. Additionally, the 24-hour lighting is in. There are air traffic controllers deploying there to augment the in-place air traffic control. And by Monday, we hope to be 24-hour ops, which would, for all practical purposes, double the amount of airlift that could go in there during the day.
General,
General, when you talk about balance with the humanitarian operations, does that in any way mean curtailing those operations or shifting them to other locations?
No, as a matter of fact, nothing should be curtailed here from the humanitarian lift. And I think, as far as I can tell, the lift of the Apache unit into Tirana has not been affected by either one, basically because of the augmentation by both air traffic controls, the controllers, the insertion of night lighting, and then, of course, when we get the all-weather approach. So thus far, we haven't had any degradation of either the humanitarian or the airflow of the Apache unit in.
How many total flights will it take, C-17 flights?
As was mentioned earlier, it looks like around 150 C-17 sorties will take that unit in. 150.
General, you said you'd have partial capability in 7 to 10 days. Can you give us an estimate of when you might have all 24 fully operational?
No, I can't right now. But it should be fairly soon after that. I would think within 30 days we'll be fully up and running at the very latest.
And can you describe what partial employment or partial capability means? Will they be operational?
Well, that once again, I won't talk about how they're going to operate. But suffice it to say, they would have some capability, depending on how the commander, the SYNC, and the air commander there decides to employ them. And I won't talk about tactics, but they could theoretically, within 7 to 10 days, be operating in some way in support of the mission. But once again, that's up to the local commander on the ground as well as the SYNC. And once again, that's hard to predict right now because of the weather and other factors. But they're intending to get the mission running as soon as they possibly can and integrate it into the air campaign.
General, last week when you announced that the Apaches were going over, I think Ken mentioned that the president has to decide once they're all in place whether they're going to be used. Is that still the case?
Right now they've been approved to deploy, and the employment decision will be made at the commander level in theater and in conjunction with the decision by the civilian leadership, and I'll let Mr. Bacon talk to that later.
Did you say force protection, partial force protection was deployed, or is that 2,000 troops? Is there any Bradleys, any Abrams tanks involved in that force protection?
No, there are no tanks involved in that whatsoever. As I said, I think a day or two ago, they have four Bradley fighting vehicles in place. I don't know the exact number of support men that are underground right now, but it's not the number of 2,000 force protection, I can tell you that. But the total number I think was talked about earlier was in the 2,500 to 2,700 range, but I'll have to check on that for sure. But no, it's not 2,000 force protection.
There have been reports of a further 24 being prepared to go. Can you discuss whether you're preparing plans to send a further 24?
No, I can't talk about any further plans in that area.
Just the situation. Are your defenses sufficiently degraded in Kosovo for you to deploy the Apaches on a limited operation in 7 to 10 days, or do you still have further to go on the air defenses?
Well, there's always further to go, and excuse me, if there's one left, that's more than enough. But they wouldn't be deploying, I should say, the Apaches there if they didn't think they could employ in theater. So all due regard would be taken. But we continue to degrade the air defenses, but in many cases with man pads and handheld SAMs and AAA, the threat will always be there. But this Apache unit, Task Force Hawk, is trained for that type of mission and that type of threat and that type of train, so they'll know how to employ.
Do you expect them to be flying within 7 to 10 days into Kosovo?
The intention is to have some capability as soon as possible. Whether they fly in Kosovo in 7 to 10 days will be a commander's decision. I can't tell you right now.
Can you tell us what the situation looks like on the ground, both with the fighting and the refugee flow?
The fighting, from what I understand, continues, sporadic fighting. The UCK continues to employ.
Southwest?
From what I understand, in various places in Kosovo, but mainly in the western and northwestern and southwest. The refugee situation I'll talk about in just a moment. But I will say that the UCK continues to engage the MUP and VJ, they seem to still have the heart to do that. The morale, from what I understand, is still fairly good.
General, along that line, there's a report that there was some cross-border fighting between Kosovo and Albania. Apparently, some Serb artillery and or mortars fired at what may be up camps or strongholds or whatever you call them Do you have any details on that, one? And two, were there any U.S. military personnel or any other U.S. personnel in the area that may have been endangered or injured in any way?
On the last part, there are no reports of any U.S. personnel in the area endangered or involved. And I think the report on the fighting is the same one that you heard, as best I can give you on that.
General, do you have any more confirmation, stronger confirmation on the rapes that Mr. Bacon spoke about yesterday?
We only have reports, I think the same reports you're probably hearing, mainly from refugees, displaced persons, and some reports from other various sources, but I can't add anything to what Mr. Bacon said yesterday.
Well, he said yesterday that you just had one firm source. Have you got more sources now reporting this?
No other sources that I know of personally. There may be, but I have not heard that.
Are you able to give us a clue as to what happened to the people that were on the way out of Kosovo, turned around? You have some recon on that?
I'm going to show you a picture a little later that'll show you what may have happened to some of them. I'm not sure it's the same ones, but we have had other photos that we've seen where buses have been lined up next to military barracks, and we have some overhead I'll show you in just a moment where there are some what looks like displaced personnel around a village in Kosovo, and of course it remains speculation where they're all going, but I will show you that.
Is this some human shield activity?
It doesn't appear to be human shield from my, there's no military activity around where I'm going to show you.
General, out of these nearly 500 aircraft that Ken Bacon referred to, could you give us an approximate percentage percentage of those would be attack planes and a percentage would be support, including air refueling, that kind of thing?
I think Mr. Bacon gave you the specifics on what they would be, but there were mainly suppression of enemy air defense aircraft, which goes back to the reference.
I'm talking about the overall total of about 500 American planes. About what percentage of those would be involved in actual attacks and what percentage would be support aircraft?
The ones I told you about, the majority will be attack aircraft, but the total number of tankers will be in the, for example, in the 100 tanker range. So the majority will be attack and type of strike attack aircraft, like suppressed enemy air defense type aircraft.
Are you still flying 24 hours?
Why don't we let him finish? He's got more slides and some video to show him then.
Okay. Quickly on the IDPs, it hasn't changed a lot. I will say that the number here continues to change. Some of these families, from what we understand, have actually moved in with other Albanian families in Albania, which helps significantly. And I will report once again that from all reports, the refugees that are on the surrounding area outside Kosovo are being taken care of fairly well. The food and shelter continues to flow in. And the coordination between the military force that's supporting the effort, as well as the civilians, the UNHCR, and NGOs, is working along very well. Just a rehash of the contributing nations, there's about 29 total nations now that have contributed in a significant way, over 2,500 tons of food, nearly 900 tons of shelter, and then the rest of the numbers as you see. So a significant lift capability over a short period of time. And from what I understand, the food situation, at least for the refugees on the surrounding areas outside of Kosovo, are being taken care of very well from a food perspective, and they're actually starting to get warm meals, and now they're getting actually bulk food. And so over the next few days, we expect most of the airlifted food, the initial crisis part of the food, the triage part, to pretty much come to a little lower level. And at some point, there's even talk of sending some of the food in via barge or ferry across the Adriatic, and then you'll get into more of a bulk flow, and they'll have better capability to provide better meals and warmer meals. Just an update at Ancona so far. Over nearly 360,000 daily rations have been sent through Ancona in 204 tents. Into Tirana, 231,000 have arrived already. That leaves about 150 to 170,000 left there. And in the scopes, you see they're starting to move a little bit more food. And then we've had another 100 or so tents. So we're getting near at least the initial U.S. contribution on that part. And that should be closed within the next couple of days. And then it'll get into more of a routine fashion with a little more deliberate and economical way of getting the food in. And just to kind of end up, once again, there's about 150,000 more to go into Albania, and then about 400,000 more humanitarian daily rations to be sent into Skopje. That concludes the charts. I've got two images I'd like to show you today. You talked about the refugees. It may be hard from where you're sitting to see, but basically there's a village here, Milosevo area in Kosovo, which is northwest of Pristina, a little bit of a blow up there. Not a lot of apparent damage in the city or the village itself, but you can see there are two areas blown up here. They're actually this distance from the city, where there are numerous tents and vehicles in both of these areas up in the hills. And this is probably a few kilometers from the city itself, where it looks like the city has been emptied, or the village, and all those displaced persons are living in the hills. Now, I can't tell you what conditions they're living under or what kind of threat they're living under, but you have to assume if they can get back home, they're in some kind of threat. So to answer your question, are we imaging them? Yes, we are.
Numbers? You too. Do you have any numbers?
There aren't specific, but it looks like in the thousands is what it's looking like.
Was this U2 imagery or synthetic radar imagery?
I won't talk about what type of imagery that is.
Predator.
That is not Predator.
Next slide. I was like, did you say that there appeared to be tents? In those fields?
It looked like there may be tents or shelter of some sort. I can't say they're tents. It may be just sheeting or plastic, but yes, they're covered. The next one is just, as I mentioned yesterday, we hit some fuel. This is not from that strike, but it's from 2 days ago on a fuel depot near Pristina. There were four large covered bunkers and two large buildings that were totally destroyed. And as was mentioned earlier, approximately 50% of the fuel reserve has now been destroyed in both the Fry and Kosovo. The last thing I have today is images or video gun camera kick film. And we'll go through that, and then I'll take questions. In both the Fry and Kosovo, approximately 50% of the fuel reserve is what was reported. Okay, as this comes up, the first one will be of an F-117, a laser-guided bomb on a bridge, Novi Sad railroad bridge in northern Serbia. And as I point out here, the bridge itself will be struck right here at the abutment. There are actually people on the bridge, none in this area when it hit. And from what we understand, nobody was injured, but it did close down the bridge. Once again, this is an F-117 with a laser-guided bomb.
What were the people doing on the bridge, General?
We don't know if they were there for promenade or if they were there to in their way of protestation, but from what we understand, there were no injuries. The next will be a SAM site, and this is off a 117 as well. You can see his laser is right over the SAM area itself, and you'll see underneath the laser in just a few moments the bombs will come in, and that was destroyed. There's one right there.
How many days ago was that?
That was 2 days ago.
Set F-15E, though, intro.
Yeah, I'm sorry, that was a 117. This is a F-16 on barracks, and this is different than the one we showed the other day. You'll see that it's in the southern Serbia area. Two 2,000-pound bombs there. He expands the picture. That's not a secondary. And then he's switching back his infrared back and forth from black to white, and you'll see two other bombs from another F-16 shortly thereafter. And those were all direct hits with no reported collateral damage.
What time of the day was that, and were the barracks occupied?
I can't tell you if they were occupied, because I really don't know, but it was night. Okay, I'll take any questions you have.
Another question of targets. The Serbs are saying today that Pristina Airport was hit with a missile, and also the town of Oroshevo. Do you have anything on that?
I can just tell you that they are flying attack missions today. And I won't talk about specific targets for today or tomorrow, but we'll report back to you later on that.
By attack missions, you mean
T-Lance? Yesterday we flew both cruise missiles and aircraft, and today I won't talk about ongoing missions.
On your refugee numbers, you have about 1 million to about 1.5 million. Do those count the internally displaced people, or are you counting those
yes,
as refugees within that?
Right.
So that's about what percentage of the population?
The reports are that there are 1.8 million Kosovo Albanians, so 1.8, 1.5 5 million out of that 1.8 are actually displaced either inside Kosovo, which the number varies between 5 and 750,000, and then the remainder are external. And that, as I said, some have actually found refuge, are still displaced, and that's in the range of about 600,000.
Mr. Bacon said we're going to go on to a 24-hour operation basis. Now, a week or so ago, you said, well, we're going up to a 24-hour tempo. Would you clarify exactly where we are on this?
Yeah. What I said a couple days ago was that we are flying day and night. The intention is to intensify that and to have as much coverage 24 hours a day as we possibly can. Therefore, more tankers, which will give us that capability. So the intention is to intensify our operations over Kosovo and to take the fight to the VJ and MUP throughout both the Serbia and Kosovo.
Will there be 100 killer teams over Kosovo 24 hours a day?
I'm not going to talk about tactics, but I will tell you that the intention is to have as many aircraft as we can, with the weather permitting, for as much time during the day as we possibly can, and to continue to increase the ops tempo.
And at night as well?
Day and night.
As a practical matter, during the when you're hunting for tanks for small units, is it necessary to operate during the day, and that's a significant advantage to you?
It's an advantage to operate whenever we can. Obviously, during the day, it's easier for us to see, although we have plenty of equipment to see at night. And it depends on, we're not sure when they're going to move, so we don't want to give them the opportunity to move. So from what I understand, they are hunkering down a little bit. They're starting to be hurt by the sustainability because of the fuel, paucity of fuel, and additionally because they are being threatened more. And from what I understand, they do real well against fighting innocent women and children, but against the UK, they're not doing as well because they can't move around so well. So our intention is to degrade them to the point where they can't be effective. And we want to do that around the clock, both day and night.
We go back to the internally displaced. You showed one photo where there was a concentration of what could have been people that had been on the road and had to turn around and come back. Now, are these people largely, are you finding them in the forests, away from the villages that have been destroyed? Are they under duress from the MUP or the VJ? What do you know?
First of all, we've heard reports, as has been mentioned by Mr. Bacon and previous in the week, that the displaced persons are, there are some atrocities being reported. As mentioned earlier, there are rapes being reported. We don't have specific information on every one of them or where they're at. We have some imagery. We're doing the best we can, time permitting, within the operation to watch for that. However, the operation militarily takes priority for reconnaissance, but reports are that they're spread out throughout Kosovo. You can see, as the photo I showed you earlier today, they may be living, some of them near their village, but not in the village. And you can only assume that the displaced persons aren't being treated very nice inside Kosovo.
Is the weather inclement to the point of the danger to the people living outside?
I think any time you're outside in wet weather, in hilly terrain, and this time of the year, I think the temperature still gets down into the low 40s, if I'm not mistaken, and there's plenty of women and children and in those type of living conditions without the sanitary conditions you need and fresh food and water, you can expect them to probably be taking a toll on them. So they're not living in luxury, and they're certainly not camping out on purpose.
When you're trying to determine the success of the mission, in the past it's been the military mission is to degrade his ability to carry out the violence in Kosovo. And to determine the success of the mission is when he stops carrying out the violence in Kosovo. How do you quantify that if he just stops versus having degraded it sufficiently so he must stop? How do you?
Well, if he stops and agrees to stop and under our terms and at the point where we think he can't come back and do this again, I think that's pretty satisfactory. So once again, I'm not going to talk about specifically when the commander thinks that time will arrive. But I think he's got in his own mind what his campaign time frame is. I won't speak to that because it's his time frame. But I know he's got what he has in mind for objectives, and I don't want to tell you that because I don't think Milosevic needs to know that.
If I could follow up, just one. If the fighting does stop in Kosovo, Can we expect to see NATO forces continuing search and destroy for days, maybe weeks to come, in spite of the fighting stopping, until you're satisfied that you've degraded it sufficiently?
Well, once again, we didn't have a military objective to stop the fighting, per se. We had a military objective, it was to degrade his capability to fight. And that, of course, is a combination of factors. One of them will be Milosevic's willingness to do that. So when that time comes and we feel his forces aren't a threat to the Kosovo Albanians or to export his force in that region, then that time will come, and we'll know when that is. It's a combination of will and capability.
General, how soon will the new planes be taking part in NATO airstrikes? How soon?
I don't know specifically the date, but they've been getting there in rapid fashion. It doesn't take very long to deploy them. So they'll get over there, get ready, get set, and... It'll be a matter of days, I'm sure.
Are the majority of these new ones from CONUS?
There are some from CONUS and some from Europe as well. And as Mr. Bacon mentioned earlier, some from the Pacific region that the F-15s.
General, in that line, if I could, is there a rotation policy being worked out for the U.S. Air Crews involved in this operation?
The rotation, I think for the Reserve and Guard, if they have a rotation, I'm sure. And that happens routinely. When I was at Aviano Air Base, we had Guard Reserve forces would come and go routinely. Most of the active duty forces that are there will probably stay there for a longer period of time, but I can't tell you the exact rotation policy. But
like in World War II, they flew 25 missions and were reassigned to different, nothing like that has been.
No, there's no limit on the number of missions you could fly. I'm sure most of them will fly as many as they can.
General, a couple of days ago, some French journalists who had gone into Kosovo with some KLA people, seen quite a lot, reported that the KLA thought that airstrikes had got rid of about 10% of the Yugoslav armored vehicles in Kosovo. It wasn't clear if they were talking about tanks or tanks plus APCs, but 10% was the figure they settled on. Do you have any sense whether that's the correct ballpark type figure?
Who reported that, please?
The French journalists who went into the KLA.
Yeah, well, there's various sources of information. It all adds up, and smarter people than me that work in intelligence add up the numbers, but it's ultimately the SYNC will determine what that number is. But I can't tell you if that has veracity or not. We do know that we're systematically destroying his military capability, not only in transportation, but sustainment, the SAMs, as well as his army in the field, and we plan to take the fight to the army in the field in a big way.
So you talked about day-night intense 24-hour-a-day operations. Can you put some caveats around that, though? This is going to be subject to the same weather limitations that you've been under for the last 3 weeks, right? Going to be cruise missiles.
It'll be the combination of all weapons we've been using in the past, and the only difference is we'll have a little bit more of it, and it'll be in more of a intense fashion. So, of course, weather always is a factor, but as we've mentioned over the last 2 or 3 days, the weather has been looking really bad, and we've still been able to get missions off. So the weather is a little bit unpredictable, but I can say this, that the commander, the Joint Forces Aerospace Commander, has forces that are prepared in a moment's notice to be launched if the weather is good, and he's got forces in place to respond for either good or bad weather. So it'll be a combination of all-weather weapons as well as the aircraft that Mr. Bacon mentioned earlier.
Does that mean that the NATO political leadership has lifted the restrictions on collateral damage, civilian casualties, because there have been no airstrikes on Belgrade, for example, during the day, supposedly to limit the collateral damage?
Well, I'll let Mr. Bacon speak to the political leadership part, but from the standpoint of collateral damage, there has been no change from the beginning of this mission.
Jim, can you talk for a second of the command and control site that was targeted near Pristina? Was that the tower that combined both military communications and as well as state television?
No, from what I understand, the strike that I depicted was on a radio relay communication site.
There was, as you know, imagery it shown at the NATO briefing this morning of that strike on that tower. So that was not represented in your presentation today?
No, it was not.
B-1s, B-2s, B-52s?
From last night, it was cruise missiles and fighter aircraft.
General, can you say whether or not the border has been opened between Kosovo and Macedonia, Kosovo and Albania?
From what I understand, there is some movement between Kosovo and Macedonia, and then you heard a report last night that they opened a border for a period of time into Albania, I believe it was, if I'm not mistaken, and then closed again. And so it's hard to predict what he's doing, but And once again, I don't want to get into the political side of this, but from a personal perspective, it's appalling to me to think what he is doing with people. And I guess it just kind of shows the kind of individual we're operating with.
General, I got a question for Kenneth.
Yeah, we can get to him with his troops as far as casualties done to his troops, and also a best general estimate for how long the air war will need to continue after it stepped up some more.
I won't give you an estimate because for various reasons. One, for security reasons. Number two is that's the commander's decision to make. And I don't have specific numbers on individual Army or Serb police casualties. We know there are taking some. We know their Army is being degraded. We expect that to be degraded even more over the next few days and into the upcoming period. Take one more question.
General, you know members of Congress are urging the President to prepare for the possibility of a ground war. Just prepare. Can you say if in this building, just on a contingency basis, if planners are just looking at the possibility on a contingency basis of ground troops?
I'll just repeat again. There's no intention right now at all to employ ground troops. The air campaign is going as planned. I think we need to understand that the campaign is just what it states. It's a period of time that with steps that are pre-planned. The campaign, from what I've seen, is an outstanding campaign. I'm sure it will succeed. But right now, I'll tell you, there is no intention to introduce ground troops.
General, well, can I ask you one air power type question? Going into this campaign, Was there an assumption that Milosevic might fold after 7 or 8 days of airstrikes, or was the assumption being that you'd be at this point, it would be 3 weeks into it, you'd still be going?
I don't know anything about any assumptions. I think anybody would have hoped that after a period of time he would have decided that this is not in his best intention, but I can tell you that the campaign was planned to go to the end. So it was, if he wants to decide to stop and comply with the demands, that's up to him, but the campaign will go until we reach that point. So there was no assumption made that it would stop at any one particular time early, I can tell you that.
Perplexing, though, 3 weeks into it, that the campaign's still going on. Is a planner like yourself kind of confused about this or surprised?
I'm a bit confused. I think the campaign's working just as it's designed.
But you've got to keep adding and adding. Yeah.
Well, it's not keep adding or adding. It's not an incremental adding. I think the campaign, as the steps are unfolding, are just exactly how General Clark planned it. And so you do adjust somewhat based on the time. The campaign, of course, is dependent on two people cooperating here. And so dependent on the weather, dependent on how Milosevic feels, that could change a little bit here and there. But the campaign is being unfolded just exactly as General Clark planned it.
You said the Allies will be adding more aircraft. Do you have a ballpark and how many?
I don't. Mr. Bacon mentioned that, but I think we can get that maybe later. But okay, one more question. That's
it. Is there sufficient ordnance in our stocks, reserves of ordnance being drawn down?
Well, as you deploy or employ weapons, they draw down a little bit. But right now, they're sufficient, and we feel comfortable with it.
Okay. When you say that the campaign is going as General Clark planned it, that implies that this addition that you're announcing today was in the plans all along. Is that accurate, or is this something that you've gotten through a phase and said, we need more than what we planned? There's a big difference.
No, I would say that the campaign itself is unfolding as General Clark planned it. The number of aircraft could vary in the matter of 10 or 12 or 15 or a dozen here or there as you go along. But as the campaign unfolds, some type of aircraft may not be needed as much as others. And as we mentioned, as we start attacking his fielded forces, there are certain type of aircraft that do that better than others, and we want to do it at an increased operational tempo. So that'll be adjusted as we go, and that's no surprise to anybody. Thank you very much.
This is 15, this is 80.
Ken, how many A-10s will... The four that are being sent, how many will that bring the total number of A-10s to?
Yeah, I believe right now I have a long list of aircraft here that doesn't include A-10s. But we will get you the number of A-10s that are there. And
do you have a ballpark in the Allied aircraft, additional
Allies? No, I anticipate from that some of the Allies will be announcing augmentations of their forces in the next few days, and I think we should just let them announce what they plan to do to their own forces. Going back to the question you asked earlier about the plans for the air campaign, we've always said from the beginning that the first goal was to attack air defense systems, the integrated air defense system. And although he continues to have an air defense system that continues to target and occasionally shoot at our plane, and I think you can see from some of the television coverage that there's extensive anti-aircraft fire, but from time to time there are also missiles being fired. We have, despite that, we believe we've gained what we call tactical maneuverability, which is the ability to fly when we need to, where we need to, with acceptable risk. The second part was to go after command and control, to degrade his ability to communicate with his troops. We've been doing that. We also have been concentrating more and more on choking off his troops in Kosovo by attacking lines of communication such as bridges, railroads, and highways, and also attacking fuel and other supplies that are necessary to sustain the troops on the ground. We're doing that and continuing to do that, but that is beginning to have an impact. We are slowly choking off the support lines that go to the troops. And now we want to concentrate more and more on the forces in the field, the forces on the ground in Kosovo. Remember, the goal has always been to degrade and diminish the forces he's been using to repress, kill, plunder, pillage in Kosovo. And that's what these additional aircraft will help us do. That's certainly what the carrier aircraft are helping us do now. But from the beginning, it was always clear to General Clark that he had to start with the integrated air defense system and then move on through other steps, getting to the point where we can concentrate more single-mindedly on the forces on the ground. And certainly the Apaches will play a part in that when they're deployed and operational. Yes.
And I'm sure you can appreciate why we keep asking that, as we're being told, everything is unfolding as it's supposed to unfold, and yet you keep intensifying and ratcheting up and adding more things and getting more permissions to bring in more armament. It sounds as if none of this stuff was planned in the first place, and you didn't expect to be into it 3 weeks and still having to bring in 80 more aircraft.
I think if you go back and check the record, everything that I've said here, everything Secretary Cohen has said, everything General Shelton has said, suggests that we expected this to be difficult and long, and we were prepared to spend the time and the weapons necessary to achieve the goal, and that's what we'll do. Obviously, if Milosevic wanted to cut this off, he could have done it at any time, and if the terms had been right, then met the 5 conditions that we've set, we would have accepted that. But the fact is he hasn't done that, and therefore we have moved through the systematic steps of this campaign. But remember, any air campaign has to begin at a starting point, and that starting point is to attack the air defense system that challenges or threatens the Allied planes. That's what we've done, and then we've moved out in the way that I've described it. We could not, from the very first day, we did attack some forces on the ground in Kosovo. I think I said that 20% of the strikes in the first day were against forces on the ground in Kosovo. But we will, as we achieve our other goals, be able to concentrate much more intensely on those forces on the ground. Yes,
Ken,
Charles.
Anything on the Canadian meeting?
Sorry?
Anything on the meeting with the
Canadian
minister?
No, it was a good meeting. It was Secretary Cohen has made it a point to talk with many of his colleagues in person or by phone on a very regular basis, and I think the Canadians feel exactly the same way we do, that this is a the campaign is proceeding systematically, that we are achieving more every day, and that we have to hang in there as a unified alliance until this job is done.
Canadians have also publicly mentioned the possibility of using ground forces. Did they discuss that?
The issue of, I wasn't at the meeting, so I can't answer that specifically, whether they discussed ground forces. Try to find out. Yeah, Tom.
Tony Quartersman had an interesting report saying that the Army, the VJ and the MUP have small caches of fuel and ammo in caves and elsewhere around the country. And their whole military doctrine is to fight a war of attrition. Have you seen any evidence of these caves or small caches? Are they using them?
We assume that they have stockpiled food, fuel, and munitions and other supplies. That clearly is their doctrine. We don't know how much they've stockpiled. Obviously, if we knew where they stockpiled it, we would attack it. But the fact is, we are already beginning to see signs that the choking campaign is beginning to have an impact. That is, it does seem to be slowing their mobility somewhat. Still, we have not seen what you all want, which is pictures of tanks that have run out of gas being abandoned on the Pesh to Pristina road. We haven't seen that. Yes.
And I had an air launch cruise missile question, not about the quantities. Aviation Week this week in their current issue had a reporter fly in one of the B-52 missions, and he makes a point in here that up until the point about a week ago, no B-52 had launched all 8 cruise missiles at once, that there were reliability problems on each of the missions. Do you have any insight into the extent of the reliability problems in hampering these the launches?
I do not.
Is that something you could check with the Fairfort, find out how many missiles have not been launched because of reliability problems?
I'll take the question.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.